Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
You can hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. It's so cute, this little microphone. All right. So we're going to start in the Word of God. If you can turn in your Bibles or in your phones to 2 Corinthians 4, 1 through 5. And what an entrance we have into the Word of God, right? We've had communion, we've had beautiful songs. In fact, one of the songs is what I'm going to be talking about. And Glenn and I had no collaboration whatsoever. It's the Holy Spirit. He's so good. Okay. Is everybody there? All right. 2 Corinthians 4, 1 through 5. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers, so they cannot see the lights of the gospel, of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, God, we just thank you for your presence here today, God. We thank you for a beautiful Thanksgiving. We can thank you, God, for all things, for all good things that you bring to us, God. And we thank you for your presence here today, God. I pray that I will decrease and you will increase, God, and we will hear the power of the word, the power that you so have given us, God, in Jesus' name, God. And we just thank you for the power in your blood, the power at the cross, God, that you have died, and that you have just given us so much, God, to be thankful for, God. Thank you, Jesus, God. I pray that we will all understand and hear you, your anointing today, God, in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so Paul, like us, we have a ministry to share and preach the gospel, don't we? I mean, it's not just for pastors or evangelists, it's for all of us Christians. Therefore, it is our job to rightly state the facts as God has given them to us, to be his witness of truth and his messenger. Much like a witness in a courtroom or in a court case, a witness is required to swear an oath, to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It is not for them to embellish, to fabricate, or to withhold any of the facts of the case. Like us, nothing less is expected. And when a witness knowingly falsifies a testimony in a court of justice, we know that that is called perjury, and that is a serious offense that comes with serious penalties. Did we tell the truth as God says it? Just the way it is. The title of my sermon is "It's Not My Truth," because it's not. I am not the responsible party that originated, that created the word. And I am not responsible for, none of us are responsible for how the audience responds to that. They are. As ministers of truth, we are responsible for one thing and one thing only. And that is to speak plainly what the Bible says, whenever and wherever we can. Yes. And we can always trust what the Bible says. It has stood on its own for thousands of years. It's withstood the test of time. It's always relevant, whether it's year 1822 or 2022. Never changes. In Hebrews 4:12, it says, "For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword, It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. As we can see, the Bible is unlike any other book that we have. It can't even be compared. And there are some really good books out there that lead us to Jesus, right? But it is the only the Bible that is God-breathed, that is living and life-changing as it does its work in us. With, of course, we can never forget the Holy Spirit. He helps us with it. He illuminates the Word. And another name for the Holy Spirit is Spirit of Truth. As we see in Hebrews, God's truth is not ordinary because it's a spiritual truth. And we are, it's not from here, it's not from our world. And it's amazing to me to see that God has chosen us to carry out his message. What an honor and a privilege it is to have been chosen to spread those eternal seeds. And what a responsibility is, isn't it? Like pure gold, the Word of God is sacred. It testifies about him. And if we taint it with our conduct or words, then we are going to bring impurities to it, to that perfect piece of gold that God never intended. In 2 Corinthians 4, Paul condemns those who taint or distort God's word in any way. About 15 years ago, I had a boss that came up to me at work, and she said, "You know, Dawn, there isn't just one truth. There are many truths." And as spiritual as I am and enlightening as it was, I responded with, "A doorknob is a doorknob, isn't it?" So looking back, it could have been a real Jesus moment. I could have just, you know, gave her just some wonderful answer, but I didn't. But what I did do is I gave the truth. A doorknob is, it's known. It is, it's, I can't think of the word. It's proof. We all know it, and we can't deny what it is, what it's been created for, and what it's been created and meant to do. We can change the colors, the sizes, the shape. We can modify it. We can change the name to fork. We can change it to clothes hanger. That's a good one, but it's not going to ever change what a doorknob really is. It is the verifiable, that's the word I was looking for, the verifiable truth. It can be verified of what a doorknob does. It opens and helps us to close the doors, right? My boss's comment that there are many truths, and when you're talking about a relatable thing, like a doorknob or something else, there can only be one real truth. That's what truth is. Everything else are ideas and opinions. And they'll always be subordinate to the one real truth. Like in a court case, a witness can give their version of what the truth is. They can tell what they think the truth is. But those things will be thrown out. In a justice court, they can be thrown out as conjecture. And what is conjecture but an opinion or a conclusion formed on the basis of incomplete information? Conjecture isn't truth. It comes from us and what we think. My boss was correct about one thing, in that Christians like myself have one truth, and that is Jesus Christ. In John 4:14-6, it says that Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through him. Jesus is the perfect, the anointed, proclaimed truth. How do we know that? How is it verifiable? How is it known? Well, I know when I spend time in the Bible, When I really get to know what the Bible says and who Jesus is, then it is what he says he is. And he is who he says he is. It can be relied upon and it can be trusted. And we have the Bible. It's an historical account of witnesses who have seen Jesus' miracles, who have been taught by him, who spoke to him, ate with him, walked with him. And then to add to all of those witness accounts, we have billions and billions of people that have passed on and who are alive today to testify that they have a personal relationship with a Jesus who is real and active in their lives. That is a verified truth. Those are firsthand accounts that he is known. God's truth isn't another idea, another religion that we can just pick out of a basket of equal things. He is the absolute truth, the one and only. Fortunately, and this is very fortunate, that we live in a country that for many years we have been blessed where people, most people here, have believed in Jesus Christ, in the one true God. And we've depended on that God, that word of God, sorry. His standards for living and the guidance that he gives with our moral principles. Thankfully, all of that has saved us for a very long time from what we are experiencing today. Today, we are experiencing increased lawlessness, chaos, confusion, needless corruption and suffering. Just the mere mention of the name Jesus is labeled offensive. We are seeing censorship of anything Jesus on our social media platforms, in our public schools, government, everywhere, really. And when we take God out, that is our safety net, we lose that protection, that safety, the trustworthiness that the Word of God gives us, that absolute truth. Instead, our country has redefined marriage, gender, murder. Not at all what God's Word says. And we're seeing that right before our eyes, the results of very godless decisions. So sharing God's Word comes with difficult and very many challenges, doesn't it? It is not a question that we will experience conflict and intimidation. We see it as people are losing their jobs. We're seeing it as families and friends are being torn apart in some instances. And yes, with censorship, we're going to be told to be quiet about your Jesus. But thankfully, we have Paul, who says not to lose heart in our ministry. In Romans 1, 16 through 17, he reminds us of why we do what we do. He says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." Paul was not ashamed of the gospel because it was good news. And he had faith that it is a salvation message with life-changing powers for everyone. I once saw a video, and my mouth is really dry. I don't want to stumble anymore here. I once saw a video at another church, and it was of a lake with a dock. And in the lake, there were people everywhere, and they were crying out, help me, and crying out, save me, and their arms, and it looked like they were drowning, and there were even people trying to crawl up on the dock to get help. And there were people on that dock, looking away. I mean, maybe they were looking at their fingernails. I don't know. Maybe there was something off in the distance, but they did not help those people. And what that video did for me is it gave me a visual representation of myself with people around me dying without Jesus. And it was really, it was a pinnacle for me. It was very difficult to see that because I was one of those people. And I did cry out. I may not have known what I was crying about. I may not have known who I was crying to or anything, but I was one of those people. And it took someone, it took a friend of mine that had faith enough. And she noticed me and she took time with me. And she had faith to extend a hand, a loving hand, to pull me up out of the muck that I was in. It took faith on her part, and it takes faith on ours. Faith is so important that without works, it is dead in the water, literally, to drowning and dying people. We have no excuse. Because if we are hesitant at any point or unsure of ourselves in our faith and helping others around us, we can ask the Holy Spirit's help. We can ask God to help us in that for wisdom. Because the definition for wisdom is, one of them, is truth practiced. And it is better than gold when we get it and we actually act in it. Look what wisdom helps us with. It helps us to rightly handle the word of truth. That is in 2 Timothy 2:15. It helps us to walk in the fear of the Lord, 2 Chronicles 19:17, and be an example for other believers, 1 Timothy 4:12. God wants to help us to share his word, that he chose us to do it in all areas of our ministry so that we can be a success to get that word out and to help save a dying world. And those, what I just gave you, are three very important lessons and practices in wisdom that I'm going to be talking about. Let us first look at how we are to wisely handle the Word of God. If we go back in history, there was a little baby in a swaddling blanket by the name of Jesus. And that baby wasn't what people over 2,000 years ago, what they were looking for in a Messiah. They had thoughts about who was going to be the one to save them, to rescue them, someone gallant, a king, a Messiah, someone strong enough, capable enough. How could an infant, a baby Jesus, be that? Like today, God's word, his truth, may not be illustrious. It may not be glamorous. It's definitely probably what we're not expecting or what we want. And it's not there to make us feel good and make us feel comfortable. When we delve into God's word, when we study it, it changes us from the inside out. And it takes faith to surrender and allow God's work to work in us. And God, while we're doing that, he refines us like fire, like pure gold. He makes it into a clear reflection of ourselves and how things truly are. That's how we get the truth. Wisdom also helps us to walk in the fear of the Lord. Pontius Pilate, he met truth face to face. He met, conversed with Jesus, and in John 18:38, after a series of questions that he gave to Jesus, he says, "What is the truth?" and then walks away. That wasn't a question. It sounded like a question, but it wasn't a question. It was a rhetorical statement because he had his mind set about Jesus. He had his own mind made up who Jesus was. And in John 19, we see that he has conviction, though. That's something. Because he tells the Jews, "Go ahead, kill Jesus. I see any basis to charge against him." And he was afraid, it says. And he did try to set Jesus free. But ultimately, where did that conviction lead him of the truth? Well, it led him to not set Jesus free. That's the answer there. But what did he do instead? He rejected Jesus and chose the crowd, chose to please others, and chose to seek others' approval. And that is for us as well. We have the truth, but do we have enough conviction of what that truth is? Because if we don't, we're going to compromise the Word of God, we're going to water it down to suit ourselves, or we're going to distort it to please others. It takes a walk in humility on our part with fear and faith and respect of God, because it is His Word and not ours. Lastly, God's wisdom helps us to be an example to other believers. In John 8:31-32, Jesus says, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." In verse 34, Jesus says that everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. What does that mean for us Christians? Well, we know it was hard for believers during John's day as well as today to believe that we are enslaved to sin, that we are enslaved to anyone or anything, but we are. We were born with a sin condition where our heart is corrupted and it is bent toward evil. And at the very core, at the very root of that sin is unbelief. So it is when we question God, His authority, His goodness, that is when we're going to rebel and we're going to reject God. Abiding in God's word, what that does is it keeps us away from that kind of hopelessness, the transgression that leads to death. We need to be grounded in God's truth. We need to keep it close. We need to learn from it. We need to obey. We need to practice all that it says, because what does it do? It sets us free. As a disciple of Jesus, we can believe and know, as the song, as Pastor Lloyd says, that we are free. We are free indeed. From the bondage and the guilt that sin brings, we really need to get this part, because we, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we are free and we walk in freedom. We walk in truth. And that is how we can be an example and an encouragement to others around us. Because it's not going to get any easier, brothers and sisters. It's not. I mean, we also have Satan, who uses when we have prejudices or stubbornness or pride, he uses that to keep us from believing in Jesus. In John 8:43-44, Jesus tells the religious leaders, "Why do you not understand what I say? It is because you cannot bear to hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and has nothing to do with the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, because he is a liar and the father of lies." Satan's lies, we have to be very clear about Satan and the lies that are always going to destroy what God has created, what he spoke into existence, who he says, and it will always, always contradict what the word of God says. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he's an author of a book that I read called Ethics, and he's one of my heroes. He said that God's truth is above the lies. It is a living truth. God will always be greater than the lies. That through our relationship with Jesus Christ, it causes a deeper, more demanding level of obedience versus obedience to an idea, to a person like ourselves or others, or even to a governing authority. We need to be careful of that. Anything that opposes the will of God and his truth. It is through this obedience that the darkness, the accusations, the deceptions, the shame, the guilt, they dissipate. When the light of God's truth can shine in our hearts and our mind, the lies, the evil then becomes exposed and they have to go. Thank you, Jesus, for that truth. Before I close, I want to make sure I close on a very positive note. I have to speak about truth's counterpart, what it is joined to, and biblically speaking, what it can't exist without, and that is love. Truth and love, at least biblically and in the kingdom of God, is never separated or divided. We see in 1 Corinthians 13 that love aims at truth. It supports truth. Love shapes truth into words. And that is the kind of language that Jesus spoke when he walked here on earth and the reason why he died on the cross for all of us. It is the divine language that spoke the world into existence and it permeates the pages of the Bible. Do you guys know how many verses are in the Bible? I was kind of astonished to look that up. And see that there are 31,102 Bible verses, which means, from what everything that I've said so far here on love, that every word, sentence, letter, punctuation, space, jot and tittle, as the Bible says, is written in truth and love. Love cannot be cut loose from the truth of God's will. 1 John 5:2. In 1 John 4:16, it says, God is love. God created love, agape love. He is the originator of that, we know. We can't know love unless God reveals it to us. And he did that in a really huge way when he revealed love through the embodiment and the truth of Jesus Christ. In 1 John 4:9, it says, God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we may live through him. In Jesus' very deed for us and the reconciliation to God, do we know what love is? That's it. And in conclusion to my message today, God's message, just like every other day, we have decisions to make. Are we going to be wise to rightly handle the truth? Are we going to walk in fear of the Lord? Are we going to be an example to other believers in the freedom that has, it's been such a huge price to pay for us to walk free? Because we have a message to preach. We do. It's not about ourselves. It's not our own ideas. But it is truth. The whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help me God. We need God's help. Because we don't want it to contain evasions, falsities, or fairy tales. The absolute truth means, what does it mean? It means that people will get offended. There's going to be upset feelings. There's most likely going to be conflict. But it is not our truth to speak, but Christ alone. It is one, and I love this, it is one of truth-filled love and love-filled truth. I'd like to write a song on that. Truth-filled love and love-filled truth, that's a very happy song because that's what God gives us. In John 3:16, what is this known verse that we all know? It actually summarizes the gospel in one sentence. For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Such freedom. I mean, how can we be contained with that kind of a message given to us? Is it hard to repeat? I mean, I love the truth. I know that I was desperate for God's truth and God's love up until I got God's truth and his love. I was a lost and dying person. And the truth is that I am saved. And if you are saved and you have been given a gift, let's not hide God's word under a basket any longer, because it is his words that are going to shine into a dark world. When we speak God's word, it is life. It is light. And we are sharing eternal seeds. So if you think, well, maybe over Thanksgiving or maybe Christmas, and you're saying something to someone in your family that's not saved, and you're saying something from God's word that you just really, you know, the Holy Spirit is sharing on your heart to give, let's not hold back. In boldness, God gives us the courage, right? As we are convicted in his truth. Let's share that, because what we are giving them does not come back void. It is eternal seeds. And that is the gift that we should be giving people, is God's truth. When Christmas is coming up, we can give them many things temporary. That's what we do, right? We live in a temporary world. We want things to be made comfortable. We want things to feel good. We do, but God's word, even though it may be hard, that is what we must give. That is the gift of the world. The gift is Jesus Christ. And we can rejoice in this ministry that we have been given because it is the mercy of God. Paul starts out with, that's what I first read. It is the mercy of God that we have been given this ministry by his grace and mercy, by his love, that we have been given the gift to share and ignite that fire in others, to help save drowning people. Let us spread this gospel message that people so need to hear. That's it. Thank you. Thank you so much.